In what seems like the stuff of Frankenstein, scientists are synthesizing artificial life. But why mess with nature? What benefit could there possibly be? Hello, DNA enthusiasts. Lisette here for DNews. Scientists are creating artificial life. What some are doing is freakishly similar to how Frankenstein assembled his monster with different pieces. But in their cases, instead of using random body parts and electricity to spring creatures to life, scientists are using empty cells and chromosomes and infusing them with fungal and bacterial life. And instead of ending up with one monster, they end up with many tiny creations. Why? Because the payoff of this artificial life can be huge. Geneticists use various processes to construct synthetic life. In one example published in Science in 2008, researchers managed to synthesize a mycoplasma. That's a type of bacteria. Scientists achieved this by first breaking down the mycoplasma's original genome into 101 pieces, which they called cassettes. Then, to create a new artificial form of the bacteria, they took 1 to 4 of these cassettes and inserted them into a host bacteria's chromosome, either E. coli or S. cerevisiae, also known as brewer's yeast. The process enabled researchers to create many different combinations of artificial bacterial life. At the time, this was a huge landmark achievement, but since then, scientists have taken Frankenlife to the next level. That's not to say the life they created was more complex. In fact, quite the opposite. Just recently, scientists at the J. Craig Venter Institute were able to synthesize a mycoplasma bacterium with an incredibly small genome, just 473 genes. To put that number into perspective, a human has about 25,000 genes. Now, it may seem futile for researchers to spend so much time creating such a simple organism, but this tiny artificial bacterium can actually tell us a lot about which genes are considered the building blocks of life. When you have an organism with a large genome, it's incredibly difficult to understand the role of each individual gene. So this small synthesized genome can help scientists isolate specific genes that they may want to turn on or off to see what happens. If the cell dies when one particular gene is taken out, then scientists know that gene is essential for life. What's more, because unlike human life, these organisms can self-replicate, scientists can have a slew of these organisms to make comparisons. Potentially, scientists can use these techniques to manipulate genes, change them in some way, or introduce foreign genes into an organism, which is also why some are worried that synthesizing artificial life is too much like playing God. However, some scientists believe that synthetic bacterial life can have significant benefits. In addition to advancing gene editing techniques and drug development, it could even help us find new ways to use our own immune system to fight off disease. But before that happens, there are some questions that remain to be answered, like whether the chromosomes present in the synthesized bacterial cells contain the entire spectrum of genes. The concern here is that these basic genomes may not really be representative of the building blocks that make up our DNA. Still, if we can better understand life's building blocks, think of what could be accomplished. We could figure out what is causing Alzheimer's disease, what feeds our cells, what influences our cognitive abilities. The possibilities are endless. Guys, we are thrilled to launch an all-new Seeker.com, which is home to all of DNews episodes, plus articles, photos, and more great videos about science, the world, and exploration. We can't wait for you to check it out. Click the link in the description below. We hope you'll share any favorite stories or news with your friends. What types of gene modifications would you want to see? Where would you draw the line? Share your thoughts in the comments and remember to subscribe so you never miss an episode of DNews. Thanks for watching.